Welcome to the show. As you can see today, Elizabeth is off. This is the Caffeinated Cooper Show. And today I have Norm Schultz, a real jive bomber. He's a jazzy cat of all jazzy cats. He comes to us with some wonderful information about all of his years on the screen, in front of the camera. Oh, the camera that we all love so much, don't we? Well, let me tell you something. One of the things we'll be talking about is IRVS. Have you heard of IRVS? It's a super club. It's a distinguished super club. And it's a private super club. Only to us, keychain holders. And we will discuss how you can be a keychain holder. So please join us on the Caffeinated Cooper Show. I'm Mary to take you along for the ride. I hope that you're having such a wonderful day today. In bits and pieces, I might seem like Elizabeth, but that's all just within your mind now, isn't it? As the dream is true and alive, so is the fun to be had.
Welcome! Here's your bubbly and beautiful host, Elizabeth. It's the Caffeinated Cooper Show.
It is the Caffeinated Cooper Show. Thank you so much for joining us. As you'll see, I'm going to be flipping characters just a little bit. I am donning raven hair and my red fascinator for such a wonderful show with Mr. Norm Schultz. But first, before we get into speaking with Norm, as he is holding in the green room so patiently and so wonderfully, I do want to bring to the screen our show sponsor, Pure Lift. Pure Lift is uplifting. It's all natural. It's clean caffeine. And as they say, whether you are late, tired, jet lagged, or on the go, needing an energy boost, Pure Lift is the perfect solution. You don't need to sacrifice your health and time to find a caffeine beverage. Now you can energize and drink and go in an instant with any of their four flavors. They have unflavored, which I've already tested. You can put that on your brownies if you want to, but definitely smoothies, in cocktail drinks, in coffee, wherever you want to put it, lemon, lime, berry, and orange. They are available on purelift.com. The scroller down below is showing their website, which is purelyft.com, or available on Amazon if you happen to be an Amazon addicted Prime account holder, such as myself. Guilty. So please go and enjoy some Pure Lift. So I have a wonderful guest. As you can see, I dipped my toes back into a little bit of a character just a moment ago as I'm going to rewatch and go, oh, I needed more time with that. Norm is not only a super cool, very genuine, very nice man. He has many accolades, which he is on IMDb if you'd like to go research. Norm. He has been on wonderful show like Blue Bloods, Alpha Girls, Possession Within, and so much more. He is also, and there are many articles out there on Google, if you just go Google his name, he is also a veteran tour guide on duck boats. So, like, it just blows my mind. I mean, he has written up time and time again. So we're going to find out more about his experience on the duck boats. And then we're going to talk about IRVS Super Club, the only place to be for a jazzy cat like you and I. So IRVS is awesome. And it is inspired by someone who is so true and dear to him. It is something that I give him so much props at creating. He created this in the beginning of the pandemic and it has absolutely taken off. So without any further ado, without any further explanation, I would love to bring to the broadcast Mr. Norm Schultz. How are you?
Hey, I'm jazztastic. It's great to be here with Elizabeth right now, but Mary was, we'll just call you Mary Elizabeth.
Oh, well,
that could
you.
Work. Yeah, we can do that. So, we're here at Herbs, and it was a late night last night. We had a lot of fun, a lot of jazzy cats here and virtually. And it's a big cleanup. I buy a lot of drinks here virtually, and Irv makes me pay for it. So I'm here cleaning up. So I thought, well, I'm already here at the bar, so I might as well just go ahead and do the show from here. I'm honored to be your guest.
Oh, thank you so much. I'm honored that you have a moment in time for me, for us to create a moment online for everyone else. And everyone who is watching, please comment. We are happy to take a look at those comments and pop them into the screen as we go. If we have any questions, Norm, I may stop you for a moment and say, oh, we have a viewer with a question if they would like to know a little bit more about the topics that we're talking about. Up to the screen right now, I have brought a picture of possibly not last night, but one of your nights.
Yeah.
And that brings me to a question about Herbs Super Club. How often do you broadcast?
It's three times a week. We're over, well over 100 shows. Started April 15th. And basically it was a way for me to just stay in contact with everyone. We, working at Blue Bloods, March 13th was our last day. Shut down and sent us all home. And suddenly I'm buzzing around the house trying to figure out how do I stay in contact with my friends? And I have a lot of friends, a lot of different things online. And so I decided one day I was just going to, do a couple quick songs and just have some fun. And it turned into something a little bit different than I intended. At first, it was going to be the Pandemic Lounge or the Coronavirus Club or something. But then I thought, let's just make it a safe place that we can all go and not talk about politics or anything like that. And definitely, there's no mask wearing allowed unless it was Halloween. And we're all safe. And you can hug here and lots of smoking and drinking because that's all good for you. Basically in 1950 or so, that's where Herbs exists. So, we do a lot of jazz music and, Sinatra and Dean Martin and Michael Bublé and Frankie Valli. And, it really has, blossomed and been a blessing. Actually, I'm touched by the amount of, private messages I get from people, just thanking me for what I've been doing. And really the thanks is for me because this has kept me sane. It's been, hours and hours of rehearsal for a 1-hour show. Came up with an idea to really contact with everybody. So I had some keychains made up and which you got yours today. And there it is. They're free. You just send me a private message with your address and I'll get them out to you. It's like a MacGyver tool for alcoholics because it's got a keychain, it's got a bottle opener, and if you're in the dark, you have a light. I don't know.
That's awesome. Yeah. So
it's that's what we call a MacGyver tool for alcoholics. But it's been a pure joy and I get verklempt on a regular basis thinking about it, but what it just built itself. And as I, started, I named it after my grandfather and,
I have a picture of him.
Oh yeah. The original Irv. That's him.
Yeah.
I was raised for the most part by my grandparents and he was, first generation Irishman, worked on the railroad and docks and was a great guy. And I think the reason I picked him because he loved to have a good stiff belt, loved to dance, and he was a true gentleman, always had his tie on, and so the rules of the club came together very quickly. No unescorted ladies at the bar. All the gentlemen must wear ties and jeans. And So it built. It was an amazing just how it layer upon layer. You know, I decided, well, what are we going to call the fan base as it was growing? You know, what are we? And I have a cat, and her name is Jasper.
Mm-hmm. I have a picture of Jasper.
Oh, yeah. So my Facebook friends are aware that she's quite the character in and of herself. There she is. And she will make appearances just randomly at the club, show up while I'm singing, because everything I do is live. So you get an hour of live music. Sometimes it's video, you know, little hitches and things, but it's all live. I think that makes it a lot more fun for all of us. And next thing you know, Jazzy's at my feet, and I'll pick her up, and she's quite the ham. She will stick her face in the microphone, purring like crazy. So it's really funny. She inspired everyone. They were like, well, let's call ourselves the Jazzy Cats. And I went, okay, who am I to question that? So then the Jazzy Cats were born at Irv's.
Perfect.
And from that, the true spiritual thing about it that I didn't intend and has been just amazing is that my grandfather was the person who, you know, you came to when you had a question. Mm-hmm. And he would tell you right or wrong. That there was no pulling punches with him. And he basically kind of inhabits Herb Ryan's lounge. And I have relatives who are in their elder years. And when they come to the show, which they do, we keep expecting Herb to show up because it's that kind of energy. And, you know, I take a drink every night with the club, because that's what you do with the club. And we always have whiskey. So even now, you know, I'm a huge coffee fiend, just like yourself. And, you know, we have a little bit of whiskey in our coffee because
I am so jealous.
It's all Ireland somewhere.
Yes,
yeah,
it is.
So we're all about, yeah, we're having all about our Irish coffee. Yes, delicious. So yeah, I started saying just a taste when I would take a, you know, a little sip, and it's more of a prop kind of Dino stuff. And my aunt reached out to me and she said, "Norm, your grandfather used to say that all the time when he took a drink. It's just a taste." And he was a true Irishman, you know. "Oh, it's just a taste. What's not the thing to worry about? It's good for you. It's good for your constitution." So if you come to Herbs, and feel free to join us. It's Facebook Live on Mondays, Tuesdays, and Fridays at 8 o'clock. And no charge. It's just basically a place to come and relax your soul, listen to some music. And so I will always tell some type of Irv joke beforehand, because Irv actually, he's here, but you never see him.
Right.
You know, we'll talk about Irv being here. So, but that's it. And it's an audience participation as well, because everyone leaves comments, and you've seen it. You know, there's a comment stream going the whole time. We have people who have made their own table of troublemakers. That would be the Table 5 girls, and they wear lampshades on their heads.
And oh, nice.
They will steal my tie while I'm out dancing, because I take little breaks and do that. Yeah, so yeah. So it's a constant stream, and everyone's very friendly and very welcoming. And if you aren't that way, you will quickly be escorted to the door by our bouncer, Harry the Hammer Freeman. So we do have a whole host of characters here. yeah. So, and basically we have guest stars as well. So,
I have a picture here of one of them. Let me scroll back. There's the keychain, and I have it scrolling on the screen down below. That if you would like to acquire entrance into the club, just send Norm a quick message and he will send you out your own keychain to enter the club. Now, this gentleman here, I've seen him on the club before.
Yes. So this is a very dear friend, a fellow actor, and an amazing musician. Tommy Bayokus. He was Laura Branigan's drummer at one time, and they were involved romantically. He's an amazing guy, very talented musician, session musician, and he's an actor as well. We met working together on Blue Bloods. And so Friday nights is Tommy's night, and he starts off the show, and he actually at home in his own studio performs a live jazz bit and then sends it off to me. And so you're getting, you know, high quality musicianship from him. And Monday nights we have a piano player named Eddie B, and he does a little live recording and sends it to me, and Eddie plays some piano pieces. And then Tuesday nights is always a special night because we have ladies night. And so we have a very dear friend of mine who has a persona named Myra Coons. Myra will come do some performances for us. And and ladies' nights, if you have your Jazzy Cat keychain, you're well aware of that.
Really?
Yes. So that's on ladies' night. Yeah. So.
So I must ask you, with all the different performers, are you taking any new performers on into the club? And if so, how could someone submit?
They can reach out to me through my Facebook page and send me a private message. And it's simple, but you know, we are discerning here at IRVS. We want you to be in the spirit of what we're doing. As you see, Tommy is wearing a tuxedo, and so we want to keep the spirit of IRVS the way it is. No modern music at all. So not that I have anything against it, but at IRVS, it kind of has a come off at like 1965. The jazz and blues stuff.
Norm, we're losing audio just one more time. Okay. Do you mind? Yep, I think you're back now. Would you mind just re-explaining that just one more time? We lost you.
Sure. If you'd like to be a guest performer, you can reach out to me in my private message me on IRVS Lounge. And we basically try to stay in the genre of the 1950s, 40s, 50s nightclub. Jazz performances and also popular Sinatra music, Michael Bublé type stuff, but it has to be in that genre. And so get your feelings hurt, right? I had a very good friend send some wonderful stuff to me. She's on like one of those, the Voice or whatever, and she's actually performed on that. And she sent me this modern stuff, and I was like, doesn't really kind of work with IRVS. And she's got a feelings hurt, but it's a dictator. It's not me. It's IRV. You know, I'm like IRV. Would you listen to this music and see if it's? Well, I'm not sure if it doesn't. It doesn't really work very well with the club. So it's not the person.
Norm, I believe we've lost you again. I'm hearing you spotted just a little bit here and there.
I can see you.
Oh yeah. No, we can see you beautifully, and we can see IRVS wonderfully. Your audio is just waning for some reason. We can continue, or if you would like to pop out and pop back in, it's completely up to you.
Whatever works best for you. I'm trying to talk, so.
Can hear you. Good. We can hear you. So we'll keep going. If I can't hear you, then why don't we just do a little hand signal? I'll just, I'll hold my hand up or something like that. And then you'll know that, our audio is gone again.
All right.
We will. What this does, you're very lucky, because what this does when we have audio problems, we have a guaranteed second show. So we'll guaranteeably do a second show if you have time for me.
Always time for you, Elizabeth. Always.
Now, let's see. We have a couple of people here that have popped in, and they're saying a few things. I'm a giant Sinatra fan, says William Glenn Russell. I even have one of his earlier autograph pictures. Whoa. He carried with him to sign for the few who got to meet him in person after his show. Wow.
That's great. Yeah, Frank was the chairman of the board for sure.
Oh my God. And then Mr. Hilton Moore out there in Texas. He is also a very fascinating person. Irish have always had an eighth flavor whiskey taste bud on their tongues. Yeah. Yeah, we sure do.
That's for sure. Yeah, you know, some Irish stuff. That's right. It's good for you. It's mother's milk.
It is. I agree with you. Well, thank you so much for going through everything about the development of herbs, when we can catch herbs. Yep. I have had the ticker on the bottom for everybody who's watching of how to contact you. And I just love that. I would love to move on to some of the other things that you've done in life, especially your acting side and then your tour guide. Like, that just sounds so small compared to what it is from what I've read in the publications that you've been written up on. So how about we go there? We'll go to the duck boats next, because from what I'm reading, you are very, very good at what you do. And I'd love to know how that all happened.
Well, I, a long time ago, I took a tour in a former life, not really, but a former marriage. And we went on this duck boat tour in Pittsburgh, and I thought to myself, this is great, but it was basically, you know, the real normal tour where, and over here is the, and here's the river. Right. And I thought, you know, there's, why can't you entertain somebody? Why can't you have a little bit of fun with it and enjoy it? So years passed and divorced and move along and I end up in Philadelphia, and I see the duck boats go by, and I went, wow, that was a lot of fun. I took the tour. It just so happened that they were looking for tour guides, especially people that had boating experience. Mm-hmm. And I'd grown up in Baltimore on the Chesapeake Bay with my cousins who owned boats and were fishermen. And so I had a lot of experience on boats. So I went in and said, you guys looking for tour guides? And they're like, yeah, you know, what do you know? And so suddenly I was thrust into this tour role. And so I made it my own. I was a history major in college. And so I love history. And to me, history is not about, you know, so much dates and places. It's more about the story of people. Mm-hmm. And Philadelphia was just so, you know, fertile in that area and so many great stories to tell. And so I thrust myself into the history of Philadelphia, gave myself a crash course, and then, you know, would tell little jokes and play music clips. It was a hour-long tour of Philadelphia in a World War II vehicle that had been outfitted as a tour vessel. And I had a lot of fun with it. It was a great run. They had some, you know, some bad publicity and some accidents later on. I, you know, moved on from then. But at the time it was, and Boston still has a great duck tour. They're huge with the duck tours up there. But what was fun for me was, you know, I made it about the people, and we'd tell jokes and stories. Like, I'd start the tour off and we'd get in the, you know, and everyone's in Philly and they're thinking, you know, of course, the Declaration of Independence. And then what's quickly after that? Cheesesteaks and Rocky. Mm-hmm. Right. So that's the modern Philadelphia. So what I'd do is I'd start the tour off with, you know, playing the theme to the Love Boat, and it would be, Love Boat, exciting and new. And everyone's like, oh, it's the Love Boat. You know, and then I go, wait a minute. This is Philadelphia. This isn't the Love Boat. We got to play the Rocky song. So then I, and then I do my Rocky imitation. I have a good time here in Philadelphia. You know, so we'd start the tour that way. And that set the tone for what was going to happen afterwards. And, just, you know, Philadelphia is just a wonderful town. I still enjoy it and visit, you know, in a little bit. But I was blessed to work in it for many years and to be the face of the Philadelphia. Did their national commercial for them, and they had sent me to Baltimore to help develop their tours. And I worked in Boston and really such great contact with people. And that was the fun part about it, that you got to tell jokes. And it was a history lesson, but you learn by accident. And that was really the fun part about it. So I miss it. I miss the tours. I miss the people, because that was what I really enjoyed. But got to do some great stuff. Got to work with the Iron Chef, Michael Simon. Yeah, I was on their television show, and they used the duck boat to go around Philadelphia, and we went to do the big cheesesteak challenge. You know, who had the best cheesesteak in Philadelphia? Yeah. And I don't have it up. I didn't get a chance to give it to you. I didn't think I was heading there, but Michael Simon was great to work with, and we got to eat cheesesteaks and have a great time with that. And so the thing I love as much as history is food, and it was just a perfect blending. So it was great. I had a really good time with it.
That's very cool. So I have the picture up on the screen where you said that they had produced a commercial. So I'm assuming that possibly both of these pictures are from the commercial shoot.
Yes, the one on right below you is from the commercial shoot. The other one I think was probably an article. It was funny having me in house. They were like, as soon as, you know, the press showed up, it was like, okay, grab Norm. Okay, all right, I'll smile. We'll have some fun. And it was a lot of fun doing that. It was, they're not there anymore. In fact, they're not in the business anymore. But at the time, it was great. It was great fun. I still have a lot of friends from that business. We stay in contact, but it was great.
That is awesome. Well, thank you for catching us up on that. Sure. Now let's move on to your work in film and television. Your IMDb has a couple of really great projects listed. There was one project, and I was just an infant in the industry, just getting into it a couple of years ago, and I really had my heart set on Blue Bloods. Never made it in. It was just too early. You know, I didn't even really have an agent to say, hey, can you get me an audition, something? But you have done some amazing time on Blue Bloods. I have a couple of projects listed here, which I had mentioned just a moment ago. But out of all of the projects that we have queued up, which one would you like to talk about first?
I don't know. I can't see what you have queued up. It's not. Oh, there you go. Well, right there are some very dear friends of mine. I landed on Blue Bloods as a stand-in for Greg Jabara, a Tony Award winner, very, very talented and probably one of the nicest people in the business that you ever want to meet. And so I worked as Greg's stand-in and, got to work very closely with him, became friends with him. We're still friends. Abigail, right in the center, people that love Blue Bloods know her as Baker. And I have to tell you, she's one of my dearest friends from the show. We stay in contact on a weekly basis. She's funny. She's smart. She's giving. And she's appeared at Herb's. She's actually come and done a song at Herb's one night.
Really?
Very, very talented. And probably one of the funniest people on the entire set of Blue Bloods is right there over my shoulder making a face, Bob Cookessy, who is, you know, the thing about him is that he's the ultimate professional, career-long actor from everything from Hill Street Blues as a cast member. He's been on Matlock. I'm a huge Andy Griffith fan, so he worked as a star on Matlock, and he's done so many movies and television shows and appearances and worked with everyone in the business. You know, Marlon Brando, he worked with Brando, and so we would sit at lunch and he would just tell these great stories about, you know, just the acting business. And I was a newcomer. I literally been acting for about 15 years. And so I learned so much. I got to work with Tony Award winners, got to work with Len Carew, who plays Pop, another Tony Award winner. I got to be his stand-in. And eventually, they gave me the opportunity to talk. and be a police officer on the show.
Yes, I have that picture.
Yep.
Go ahead. While you're talking, I'll find it and bring it up.
Yes. Yeah, so I had an opportunity to audition. One of our executive producers decided that, you know, why go outside to cast some people? We have some talent in here. And I had a little bit of a leg up as a stand-in because we actually do the lines on Blue Blood. So, they had seen me work. I always joke about, you know, when you see Garrett do something on Blue Bloods, I probably did it a lot more times than he did to set all the sound and all the lighting. So I got to work as a police officer, and I've had several co-star credits as a uniform in Precinct. It's great. Donnie Wahlberg, I work in his precinct, and I have to say Donnie gets it. He treats his fans right. He's an amazing guy. Marissa right there, Ramirez, they're two just wonderful people to be around and watch them work. It was just an education in and of itself. It was like, I always say it was actor boot camp, you know, working around Tom Selleck, which is, you know, he's a consummate professional. And it was always kind of funny. It was like working with Tom was like being with the grownups, you know? And then when you worked with Donnie, it was like being at the kids' table. You know? You're going to laugh. You're going to have fun. It was just an amazing experience. I did not go back because of the pandemic. And so I really just kind of taking care of myself and staying home for myself and everybody else. And I miss it. And I'm in contact with lots of the crew members and cast members. And we stay in touch. And we all tell each other how much we miss each other. It's a great show. And the fans for Blue Bloods are amazing.
That one. And there's another show here that you did some work on, Empire. That is another one that has an amazing fan base.
Yeah, Boardwalk Empire. That was really my first regular core background job, and I was one of the rich people that hung out at the nightclub with Steve Buscemi and Bob Cohesi was actually on that show as well. The second season, I was in every episode somehow. You'll see me in the background, maybe just my ear, you know, but it was a lot of fun. And so I eventually, after a year of doing that, the character that I was tied in with got whacked, you know, as happens with gangsters. And so I was given an opportunity to audition and come back, not in that group, but to play a character. And you see me in a scene with Steve Buscemi, who is an amazing guy. And I was lucky I didn't get whacked because I'm sitting here playing cards with him. It's a funny story about that. When I see that picture, we went in to shoot the scene and went to lunch, and I got food poisoning at lunch.
No.
I was so sick, and I'm sitting there at the table, and I am on, and this is my second time having lines on the show. And so I didn't want to look like I was nervous, and I was sick because I was nervous. But at the same time, I was becoming violently ill while sitting there at the table. Now, I didn't want to say anything. And so it was so bad that I had like a little, you know, plastic cup, and I had it down underneath the table just in case I couldn't, you know. So I sat there, and Steve Buscemi, after we did a couple takes, he turned and he looked at me, and you know, he was a firefighter, and he knew a lot about people and first responders. And so I think he saw that I was in distress, and he looked at me and he said, are you okay? And I said, I think I ate something bad at lunch. And he's like, okay, you know, and he looked over at the director and he said, could I take a break? So he took a break for me. Now, it's even funnier, and it shows what a great guy he is. As soon as I got up from the seat, I was sick. I mean, I'd been holding it down. And so then I went to the, you've been to Steiner Studios. It's huge. And we were filming we were filming at Steiner's. I went into the bathroom to the far stall, as far away as I could be from anybody, just in case. I was so embarrassed and so sick. And then while you're in the middle of something like that happening, the door opens up and I hear footsteps, click, click, click. And I'm like, oh God, I hope they just stop up there, you know, and click, 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 and comes to the door where I'm at. And I'm like, it's occupied, you know, and it's Steve Buscemi.
Oh, wow.
Are you okay? I brought you a Coke. And he slid a Coke underneath the stall to me. And he said, drink that and just come back when you feel better. Okay, we'll wait.
Oh, wow.
So that was my last appearance on Boardwalk. But at the same time, it was just the humanity of Steve Buscemi and the camaraderie ship. It was an experience. So when I look at that picture, I think about that. I was like, wow, I was so sick while I was sitting there. but I got through it because the show must go on.
Yes. And how humble, you know, we hear all of the negative stories, but we don't ever hear all that often. Definitely not as often as we should.
It's true.
Positivity and just how humble so many very famous people are.
He's very funny because I had to take a break from Blue Bloods standing in for Greg. Another really funny story, if I still have time.
Of course you do.
Greg and I became very good friends, and we still talk, you know, regularly. And so I wasn't there one day, and I never missed a day of work. And so Greg texted me, you know, Norm, are you okay? And I said, I'm actually in rehearsals on Boardwalk Empire for that part. And he goes, are you working with Buscemi? And I was like, I am. And he goes, you know, I know Steve. He said, do me a favor, you know, tell him I said hi, and tell him he's dead to me for not coming to see me. Right. And I'm like, oh my. And I'm driving to the studio thinking to myself, how did I get in this place? Number one. And so the occasion came up and we sat there and Steve came in and sat down. And I said, Steve, we have a mutual friend. And he was like, really? Who's that? And I go, Greg Jabara. And he goes, oh, how do you know Greg? And I go, I'm his stand-in at Blue Bloods. And he goes, oh, yeah. I said, and he has a message for you. And Steve was like, really? And I said, yeah, Greg wanted me to say hi to you and to tell you that you're dead to him for not coming to see him in Billy Elliot, for which he won the Tony. And you know, Steve just laughed and he said, okay, well, I have a message for Greg.
Oh, no.
And, like, okay. And he goes, tell Greg, thank you. It's nice to see him. And thanks for sending his regards. And tell him to watch his butt because you're younger and more handsome than him.
Oh, that's a great reply. But now you've got butterflies going back to
so
Jamal.
Now I went, and he just laughed and laughed and laughed. You know, we understood that. So, but that was a lot of fun. That was just little magic moments that have happened. I'm a huge movie and television fan, always have been. And to get the opportunity to just have, you know, the experiences I've had. And I have to apologize. I have a terrible habit of not updating my IMDb page. And there's a lot of stuff on there that I haven't put on, like season one of Bull. I was a bad anesthesiologist. So that was fun, you know. And if you think about it, it was the precursor to what we're doing now, because we all had to wear masks in the operating room and we were acting with masks. You know, doctor, I don't think that it's going to make it.
Right. So at least you're the only one, let's not say the only person, but you're a group of people who know how to project while speaking under a mask.
We because the one actress who was the nurse, she wanted to pull her mask down. And we had this wonderful tech that was there. She's like, not in an operating room, honey. We can't have that in the operating room. Act with your mask up. So
I have one final picture to talk about. And this one looks like a really interesting one.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, hey, welcome to 1972, looks like. one of the fun parts of being an actor and doing some of the background stuff that I've done is been able to dress in period clothing. This was for the movie American Hustle. It was great. We were working on location and at the Plaza in New York, and I was one of the four people that the production people knew, our ADs knew, that I'd behaved myself on set. Mm-hmm. And so they sat me inside the lobby, and I had to do a crucial cross, crucial cross, against Christian Bale's character. Now, we all know, at least those of us in the acting business, that he can be volatile. If you have noise in the background, I'm sure everyone's heard his rant on Batman and what happened there. And so I'm just there over there minding my own business. I mean, my pants did the talking for themselves. So I just stood there and Christian Bale's pacing and he's working on his line. And we know as actors, that's a bad sign. When you're pacing and working on your line, usually you can just, you have it in your head, but when you're pacing and doing it, you're like, as another actor, you're just like, oh my, this is. And so I was trying not to breathe, not to move, as well as the rest of the crew. Suddenly, Christian Bale just stopped dead in the middle of the Plaza lobby and looked over at me. And I was looking for a hole in the ground to, because I thought, did I breathe too loud? Did I? And he came walking towards me very purposely. And I could see the production people all squirming like, oh my God, what's going to happen? What's going to happen? What did this guy do? We're going to throw him off the set. And I'm just sitting there like, mm-hmm. And he walks up to me and he goes, those are some happening pants. And I went, well, I thank you. And he goes, are they yours or are they wardrobes? And I was like, they're mine. And he goes, good man, great pants. And then he turned around and walked away. And collectively, the entire set was like, ah. So, let me stay. Apparently, Christian Bale liked my pants.
Wow. And they're yours. Do you still have them?
I might have them in a trunk somewhere because we all kind of collect that period. We know that when you show up the set and you have period wardrobe, you get paid for it.
So, yeah, you sure do.
You know, and you don't have to stand in a wardrobe line to give it back at the end of the night. You just pack your crap up or hop on the G train, you know, entertain the tourists in that outfit. So
that is awesome. What a great story. It was fun. Well, you're just full of stories. And before we end the show, I'm going to, and I didn't prep you for this, but Okay. Before we end the show, I'm going to leave it up to you. Would you like to entertain in a story, tell us a joke, or sing a song?
Oh, let's see. Well, I can tell you what happened here at Irv's the other day.
Okay.
It was, you know, well, Irv really doesn't spend too much time in the bar. He comes in, he collects the receipts and makes sure that everything's been ordered properly. But then from that point on, something usually happens that just kind of upsets him. So, and then he leaves the bar and to sue our imaginary bartender and the rest of us, we take care of the bar when Irv isn't here. And there was a gentleman sitting here, earlier today, and he had a glass sitting there. He obviously emptied it out, and Irv walked over to him. And you know, you can't have customers sitting at the bar with empty glasses. And Irv said to him, "Oh, excuse me, sir. Oh, I noticed that you're sitting there with an empty glass. I was wondering, would you like another one?" And he said to him, "Well, why would I do with two empty glasses?" That's the kind of thing that Irv does. Well, since that was a quick story, what you want to do? You want to sing with me?
I am one of those singers that needs like the keys to be blown.
Just follow along, and we like to end our Irv evenings with this song, and it's one of the modern songs that we allow at Irv's Lounge, but it speaks to my heart and to our jazzy cats. So this. You've got a friend in me. You've got a friend in me. When the road looks rough ahead and you're miles from your nice warm bed, just remember what your pal Norm said. You've got a friend in me. You've got a friend in me. You've got a pal in me. You've got a pal in me. If you've got troubles, then I've got them too. There isn't anything I wouldn't do for you. We'll stick together and see it through. You've got a friend in me. You've got a friend in me. Oh, that's how we finish the show off a lot. So we call our friends Jazzy Cats here. So you will always have a friend at Irv. So come back anytime. Oh, and when you have your keychain, you get 25% off at Adam's Cabs upstairs.
That's wonderful. What about the coat check?
Lizzie runs our coat check. Lizzie, the coat check girl. We call her Busy Lizzie. And sometimes she comes and does duets with me, but she's very camera shy. So. We have a whole staff here, anytime. Well, not anytime. Mondays, Tuesdays, and Fridays at 8 o'clock. If you need to get away from the world, listen some music, have some fun, you're welcome at Irv's anytime.
Please message Norm Schultz today for your Jazzy Cats keychain, and we will see you. Those are all Eastern times, correct?
Correct. And we have a YouTube channel that we're building, so you can check out repeats on YouTube as well if you don't have Facebook.
Well, I'm going to propose something. So the next time that you have a special segment coming to Irv's, would you mind letting me know? And then maybe we can do a shorter show, but a quick show, and we can talk all about Irv's and what's coming and promote the next showing and drive a couple of our people on over to YouTube to press that subscribe button.
It would be my pleasure.
Oh, thank you so much.
Merci beaucoup, madame.
Oh, I do love a man who can speak a little French. Oh my goodness. Thank you. This was such a fun show. I have Michael Schwartz here saying, awesome. I have Susan saying, wonderful, entertaining interview.
Oh,
I
agree. Susan's one of our jazzy cats.
Oh, a friend of the keychains. Ah, I will have to come in.
Yeah, she was here with the Table 5 girl. She's trouble.
I like the girls that are trouble. Put me at Table 5, please.
Oh, yeah, and then you'll end up with something like this. Oh, this was left over from the other night. So,
that is awesome. Well, now that I have my keychain, I'll certainly be there. I will be commenting, liking, sharing everything that I can do to promote the show. You are a pure joy. Regina, is she a Table 5 lady as well?
Regina has her own table, but yes, she's also one of our jazzy cats, and she's amazing, beautiful, funny, and just a joy. We've been friends for years and years. Yep. Great.
Oh, that's wonderful. Well, we have William Glenn Russell. He is also known as the Gorehound. He is a fan of the show, and he loves horror. So he says that he needs to get his keychain because this sounds like a whole lot of fun. It certainly does. Jim Valente, thank you for tuning in. Regina, Rocket Girl, again, she says, hey.
Hey.
All right, Norm, thank you so much. I hope that you truly enjoy every moment that is left in today and this evening. And please tell your lovely wife that I said thank you for a few moments of your time to come and share with us.
Well, if I had one of those, I'd tell her.